Is that better? Can you hear me? Okay. Okay, so about the college ethos that we have, which is we believe in the democratic process, and we invite all our friends who are liberals, progressives, as long as you believe in the democratic process, we're glad to meet and talk with people. So we're glad you're here. I want to say, before I introduce also Dr. Grabar, that I was reading a book that was not, I want to make clear, not written by Dr. Grabar. It was called Bringing Down America, and it's about an FBI agent who infiltrated the Weatherman Group that she will talk about. And while the book, it was published originally in 76, republished last year with a new foreword, and this man, Grathwall, he died this year, and I think we owe him a great deal because he was a sacrificial contributor to America, and he was a good man. So I just wanted to mention that at the outset. So Dr. Grabar is a person that I first saw published on my favorite website, which is townhall.com. And of course, everybody has a place where they just want to start the day and read news with like-minded people. So townhall.com is my favorite. It's got a lot of big shots on there, and Mary is right among them. She is also published with Front Page Magazine, which is written by David Horowitz. And if you've ever heard of Horowitz, you know that he used to be a hardcore lefty in the 60s, but he saw the light and he became a patriot, and he's very well known in the academic community. And Dr. Grabar has been to a lot of conferences, done a lot of speaking, and so I'm just gonna let her take over. Glad to have you.
Thank you. Did you want to?
Yeah, that's what you said.
Okay. It's good to be here, and I really, am I speaking into this microphone or this one right here? Okay, can everybody hear me? Okay, great. I've been teaching for 20 years, and this is the first time I'm not teaching this year. I was teaching in a program called the Program in American Democracy and Citizenship at Emory University. It was funded by a private grant, and it was not refunded this year. So I was telling people where I was speaking, it felt really odd in August not to have to prepare a syllabus. I was like, what am I going to do with myself? But anyway, that gives me more time to write and to speak to people. I've been speaking to some Tea Party groups throughout Georgia. Can you hear me? Okay. And he always gives me material. I've been tracking him since about 2008, and when he came into the news, and he's one of the people, I might get in trouble for this, but he's in my target. and he deserves to be. He's one of those radicals in education that I see as destroying our youth. He is a bad person. I'm also working on a book at the present time. I've got this nonprofit that I've started. I'm still waiting to hear from the IRS. I applied in February. I have this nonprofit called Dissident Prof Education Project, where I do these projects. But I'm working on a book right now. And it's about the American character. And what I'm doing is I'm using my own experiences as an immigrant. I know I don't sound like an immigrant, but I am an immigrant. I came here when I was 2 years old. My parents brought me from communist Yugoslavia at the time. I'll reveal my age here. I think that was 1958. Okay, it was very much communist then. And I used to talk about this with my students at Emory when I was teaching there, and talk about Yugoslavia. Well, this is a map of Cold War Europe, and you can see where Yugoslavia was. It was ruled by Marshal Tito, so it wasn't wasn't part of the Soviet Pact, but it was communist nonetheless. So Slovenia, where's the thing for that? So Slovenia gained independence, broke away in 1991, and I would ask my students if they knew where Slovenia was, and they didn't, they hadn't heard of it. How many of you have heard of Slovenia? Okay, some have, okay. Those of you who haven't, don't feel bad because George W. Bush didn't know where it was or he mistook it for Slovakia. But this is where Slovenia is now. It was the northernmost republic of the communist Yugoslavia. And so it's that tiny little green, dark green country there that's bordered by, on the west by Italy, on the north by Austria, and on the east by Hungary. And my parents, like many people, had to escape in the middle of the night to leave Yugoslavia because they had to get past the border guards, and they spent a year as refugees in Austria. And a lot of people don't know about that. And so what I want to do is to sort of talk about my experiences. So my book's going to be part memoir and part analysis of the American character. So this is the country I'm from, and if we want to look at how big Slovenia is in comparison to the United States, there it is. It's about the size of New Jersey. It's got a population of slightly over 2 million people. There are actually more Slovenians living abroad than live there. Largest concentration is in Cleveland, and you will know more about Slovenia than you ever hope to. And the reason I point out the size of this is because throughout Slovenia, this tiny country, the size of New Jersey, there are over 600 unmarked mass graves. These are people who resisted the communist takeover. And some of them were sent back from Austria in 1945. They thought they were going someplace else, but they were released back, and the partisans, as they were called, what they did is they just took men, women, and children, rounded them up in these big pits and just shot them. So just imagine a state like New Jersey having 600 unmarked graves, mass graves, where there are men, women, and children. And you come across a farmer, a poor farmer, who might, he would be in his 80s now, but who might remember this massacre, but he's too afraid to speak about it to this present day. Okay, so Slovenia is supposed to have a parliamentary government now. I've talked to some older Slovenians from there, and they say, well, the Reds are still in there. Okay, so this is a country that still has these unmarked graves. And of late, I've been thinking about character. As I was teaching at Emory, I was teaching Alexis de Tocqueville, Democracy in America, one of my favorite books. How many of you have read Democracy in America or passages from it? Okay, good. Whenever I open that up, it's like, oh yes, I can see what he's talking about. It's still going on today. And I thought, wow, I'm seeing this, and I'm wondering if people who grew up here and didn't grow up in immigrant families can see what he's seeing. And so I wanted to talk about the difference in character and what it was like for people of my parents' generation who came here. And at a conference in 2008, the Slavic Studies Association, which is based in Cleveland, of course, I think, I met this man named Metod Milac, who was a survivor. He was a college student. He was captured by both the Nazis and the communists. And he spent some time at Auschwitz in the labor camp, not in the concentration camp. He escaped, and he was one of those displaced persons after World War II who came to the United States seeking refuge, and he built a life here, as many did. And these displaced persons have always fascinated me. I kind of grew up with the children of them, and I noticed, you know, there were certain characteristics that they had. Well, anyway, recently, as I was at a conference, I thought, gee, no one knows their stories. How many of you had heard of displaced persons? Okay. So yeah, about half of you know, but a lot of people don't know about them and their experiences. And so I wrote an email to my friend. He's written a couple books about his experiences, and I said, I have this idea. I'd like to edit a collection of writings by these people, or stories by these people. And he wrote back this kind of heartbreaking email, and he said, I know a lot of people, but they will not talk to you. They are still afraid to talk about this. Okay, they have relatives there, and they're afraid for the relatives in Slovenia what's going to happen to them. So there is still this fear, and there's this there's a different character that I've noticed among people who came from Eastern and Central Europe and their children. Their children inherited certain attitudes. Between them and people who grew up in America, who grew up in the United States. And where does this come from? Well, I think it comes from our educational system. So my book is going to be titled An American Education. And who is one of these people who's changing the character? Bill Ayers. Okay, and I just realized, or I learned, that there was a question on Jeopardy about Bill Ayers. As Bill Ayers was in a 60s radical group called this, maybe he forecast later being an Illinois education professor. So what was this group? Buddy, no. Weather Underground, right. It was the Weathermen initially, until they had to be fugitives from the law, but it was the Weathermen. And Michelle Malkin and some other conservatives complained that you know, that college students were now being required to know about Bill Ayers. One of the things they didn't like was the fact that he was just characterized as being in a radical group, and that then he was an education professor, which he was. So, Bill Ayers, as I said, is giving me a lot of work to do of late. And I thought, well, students should know who Bill Ayers is. And I would ask my students at Emory if they knew who he was, and he came into the news in 2008. And I know you college students probably were, what, 13, 14 at the time of the 2008 election? Paying attention to politics? Probably not that much. But I felt the students should know who he is because he's doing the college circuit speaking tour again. He is going to be speaking in a couple days on Thursday at Elgin Community College in Illinois. And so he has been asked to speak there. And he's going to be talking about his new book, I think, in part, which is titled Public Enemy, Confessions of an American Dissident. Okay, so who is Bill Ayers? Is he just a radical, or did he just belong to a radical group and protest the Vietnam War? Is he a legitimate education professor? Is he someone who has a respectable position and has done respectable work? Well, this is a picture of Bill Ayers. Okay, as you can see, this is not a young man, in the height of his youthful idealism, but this is a man in his late 50s, and this is a posed picture, and this is the picture that was sent out with the publication of his book called Fugitive Days. That was his first memoir. Now he's coming out next month with a sequel to that memoir. And here he is deliberately posing on a flag for the release of this book. However, Bill Ayers, if we look on the handout, the first passage I've quoted, and this is a blog post from about last week, this is what he writes. In the heat of the 2008 presidential election, Barack Obama's opponents were spinning a chilling narrative that cast him as an enigmatic figure with a group of shadowy associates, including a black nationalist preacher, that would be Jeremiah Wright, a Palestinian professor, and an unrepentant domestic terrorist. So he's speaking about himself in the third person if he wrote this. That imagined terrorist was Bill Ayers, a one-time leader of the Weather Underground. The McCain campaign spent millions of dollars demonizing Ayers, specifically in castigating Senator Obama for, in Sarah Palin's deathless phrase, palling around with terrorists. Okay, this is how he's characterizing himself, and this is the way he's going to be characterizing himself as he's speaking at community college campuses in these forums on the humanities. So is that an accurate representation of his history? Well, here are some FBI posters. This one on the far left is of Bill Ayers, Kathy Boudin, and Judith Clark, and Bernadine Dorn on the far right. Bernadine Dorn became his wife. So, what is Bill Ayers' real history? He was a leader of the Weather Underground. This was a domestic terrorist group. He participated in the bombings of the New York City Police Headquarters in 1970. The Capitol Building in 1971, and the Pentagon in 1972. And of course, he worked as an education professor. That is true, he did have that position from 1987 to 2010. Bill Ayers was born in 1944, and he was raised in a affluent Chicago suburb. His father was Thomas Ayers, who was an influential person politically. He was the chair of Con Edison there. But Bill Ayers became radicalized in his teenage years, as he writes about in Fugitive Days. In the mid-1960s, he taught at a radical alternative school, part of the Free School Movement. This was a place where students addressed their teachers by their first name. And he brags in Fugitive Days that I walked out of jail and into my first teaching job. So this is something he brags about. By the age of 21, he was the director of that school. In 1968, he earned a BA in American Studies from the University of Michigan. In the late 1960s, Bill Ayers and Bernadine Dorn co-founded the Weather the Weathermen, which became the Weather Underground. This was a splinter of SDS. Anybody know who the SDS was? Students for a Democratic Society. Right, it was a group that was organized by the socialist Al Haber in 1960. So Bernadine Dorn and Bill Ayers thought that the tactics of the Students for a Democratic Society weren't radical enough, and they advocated using violence. Okay, in 1969 at the University of Oregon, Ayers boasted of the Students for a Democratic Society role in the Venceremos Brigades, a project that was initiated by the Cuban government, where these students or these young adults went to Cuba. Excuse me. They were supposed to be working in the fields, but they were actually training in guerrilla warfare. In 1969, Ayers was a participant in the 1969 Days of Rage riots in Chicago, and there were 300 members of the organization. They committed acts of violence, arson, and attacks against police and civilians alike. They called the police pigs. Ayers refers to the police as pigs in his memoir, Fugitive Days. Their long-term goal, however, was to cause the collapse of the United States. Bill Ayers, as you can see in that blog post, denies that he was ever a terrorist. Thank you. But if you just read Fugitive Days, you will see several passages where he admits to participating in bombings. They bombed the city police headquarters in New York, as I said, the Capitol, the Pentagon, and on one page, Bill Ayers even writes, "Everything was absolutely ideal. The sky was blue, the birds were singing, and the bastards were finally going to get what was coming to them." And this is what he says about the day that they bombed the Pentagon. Okay, so Ayers and the Weather Underground were responsible for 30 bombings aimed at destroying the defense and security infrastructure of the U.S. Bill Ayers famously, on September 11, 2001, in a New York Times interview, said that, "I don't regret setting bombs." And he said, I didn't feel we did enough. And then in his memoir, he also wrote, "I can't imagine dismissing the possibility of doing it again." In 1970, a bomb that was intended for Fort Dix, where American soldiers were going to be attending a dance with their dates, accidentally went off in a Greenwich Village townhouse, killing three members of the Weathermen, including Diana Otten, who was Bill Ayers' girlfriend at the time. And while they were on the run, Bill Ayers co-authored this document called Prairie Fire, The Politics of Revolutionary Anti-Imperialism. And just a couple of quotes. "For more evidence that he was involved in terroristic activities, they said, 'We are a guerrilla organization. We are communist women and men, deeply affected by the historic events of our time and the struggle against U.S. imperialism. Our intention is to disrupt the empire, to incapacitate it, to put pressure on the cracks. And finally, our job is to tap the discontent seething in many sectors of the population, to find allies everywhere people are hungry or angry, to mobilize poor and working people against imperialism." Okay, so how was he going to find people who are discontented? Well, in 1980, Bill Ayers and Bernadine Dorn emerged from hiding, and they were let off because of an FBI oversight. And so the charges against them were dropped because of this technicality. And Bill Ayers famously said that he was guilty as a bird, guilty as sin, free as a bird, America is a great country. Bill Ayers then immediately went on and earned a master's and then a doctorate in education. The doctorate was from Columbia. He immediately got a job at the University of Illinois in Chicago, rose up the academic ladder and gained tenure, and then became a distinguished professor. Okay, so what is Bill Ayers' objective in education? Okay, so basically, his influences, as he notes them in his memoir and his writings, are Ho Chi Minh, Che Guevara, communists. He refers to these. Bill Ayers was doing what the SDS was doing and what they said they were going to do in their manifesto called the Port Huron Statement. And they were going to change the strategy, and this is what Bill Ayers did in the 1980s and onward. He didn't bring down the U.S. government through bombings. He realized he couldn't do that, so he went into education. And he basically followed what the SDS said they were going to do in their meeting in 1962. They were the new left, and they were going to reject the old style communist strategies, and they were going to work to transform the government of the United States into a participatory democracy, or as some people would call it, a Soviet democracy. It's the kind of democracy that James Madison warned about in Federalist Number 10. He said these kinds of democracies have been short-lived and violent, if you read history. So they were going to do this by infiltrating the universities and by making political life an adjunct to the academic life. Okay, and the academic life has traditionally been one that has been the pursuit of knowledge for its own sake. So as a result of what this generation did by coming into the universities, gaining tenure, hiring people who agree with them, is to make academics into activism. So today we have professors who will openly advertise themselves as activists on their websites at public universities. And Bill Ayers is, one of the people who is doing this, and he is very influential because he has been training generations of teachers. The school that Bill Ayers teaches at is the University of Illinois at Chicago, which specializes in training teachers for urban schools. So what they were trying to do, as they said in Prairie Fire, which is to go and find those people who are discontented and organize them, is he's been training teachers to go into these schools. Okay, why are they doing this? Well, why didn't communism ever catch on in the United States? The person who ran the program I was teaching at Emory, Harvey Clare, talks about, or he writes about communism, that's his focus, American communism. Why didn't communism catch on in the United States? There's always, there's been the Communist Party since 1919, but it was just a very tiny percentage.
Because of our Judeo-Christian foundation, maybe?
Yes. A big part of it. And the first thing the communists did when they took over was, of course, to kill the priests and nuns and to kill the ministers, right? because that interferes with their objectives. Richard Pipes, who is the Russian historian, writes that Russia lacked the deterrence to social revolution, and as he's going through the history of Russia, present in the West, which is respect for law and property, along with a sense of allegiance to a state that protected liberty and provided social services. And I have this quote as the second quote on the handout. The Russian radical intelligentsia, permeated with utopian idealism on the one hand and a peasantry bent on seizing private land on the other, created a state of permanent tension liable to explode any time the central government found itself in trouble. Okay, so you have a radical intelligentsia and a peasantry. People who are discontent, who are maybe not literate, who resent the property that others have and a government that doesn't protect property. So what better way to form this than to, you know, find those people and go to the schools and find them? Okay, so we have the radical intelligentsia, the academics, and the peasantry. And when I would talk about the peasants, which is the class that my parents came from, my students didn't know what that meant. And I've copied the dictionary definition on the handout. And the dictionary, the American Heritage College Dictionary, says a peasant is a member of the class comprising small farmers and tenants, sharecroppers and laborers on the land, a country person, a rustic and uncouth, crude or ill-bred person, a boor. Okay, but that doesn't capture it. And Tocqueville understood that. Most people don't know what a peasant is. When I would ask my students, they said, what is a peasant? Well, Tocqueville said, the Americans never use the word peasant because they have no idea of the class which that term denotes. Okay, so in 1830, 1831, the French aristocrat, Alexis de Tocqueville, is traveling across the United States and he makes this observation, Americans don't know what the peasant is. Okay, why don't they know what the peasant is? There must be something more to being a peasant than just being a farm laborer or being an uncouth person, an uneducated person. Well, being a peasant implies that it's a social class that you cannot leave. So in Europe, there were peasants. In America, there were not any peasants. In America, there were servants and masters. But the servants and the masters treated each other respectfully because the master knew that at any time the servant might become his master. There was the condition of equality in the United States. So that's one observation that Alexis de Tocqueville makes. And as I've been doing some reading making notes for my book, I remember a short story by Anthony Bukowski, who is a first-generation Polish writer. I think he recently retired from teaching English. And he writes a short story that captures that essence of people who just feel helpless to do anything about their situation. Their daughter and sister is seduced. They can't do anything. They have this mindset that they are peasants. Okay, so what other things does Tocqueville have to say about character? As he goes on talking about peasants, this is in volume two, he says, you know, the closest that might come to a peasant might be the person who goes out into the woods and builds a log cabin. But is this person like a peasant? He may live in this very primitive structure where you can see daylight through the boards, But this person is not like a peasant. He is literate. He knows about the past. He knows about the present. And he can debate politics with you. And he says that this pioneer, this American pioneer, knows his rights. He goes into the woods. He strikes out for the wilderness and settles it. And he carries with him three things: the Bible, an axe, and some newspapers. So he is very well informed. And you can have a conversation with this guy. And he knows more than the French intellectuals. So there's something about the character. A peasant would not be able to do this. Okay, so I noticed that, and so I'm going to be drawing on Tocqueville quite a bit because I think he has a lot to say about the American character. There's also someone else by the name of Mary Anton who wrote a book in 1912 called The Promised Land. Anybody heard of Mary Anton? You have, great, great. I think she's in some anthologies, she's in an English class, maybe? Okay. Mary Anton, which was not her original name in Russian, was an immigrant as a girl. And she came over to the United States, obviously, I think her mother came to meet her father. But I was struck by a passage from her autobiography. She writes about George Washington. And she writes, "But a human being, strictly good, perfectly wise, and unfailingly valiant, all at the same time, I had never heard or dreamed of." Here she is trying to recreate her experience as a girl in a public school. And she continues, "This wonderful George Washington was as inimitable as he was irreproachable. Even if I had never, never told a lie, I could not compare myself to George Washington, for I was not brave. I was afraid to go out when snowballs whizzed, and I could never be the first president of the United States." Well, obviously, George Washington was, right? How many of you, when you were first exposed to George Washington, learned about him and the cherry tree? Okay, well, that's good. Okay, that's what I learned, that George Washington could not even tell a lie to his father, which I think is a great thing to teach young children, because he was the first president. And I think children need to have heroes. And I'll continue on with what Mary Anton writes. So obviously she's recreating this experience of this man who is on a pedestal, right? This larger than life figure, this almost godlike person. She continues, "The twin of my newborn humility, paradoxical as it may seem, was a sense of dignity I had never known before." So even though he's up on a pedestal, she's getting a sense of dignity. She continues, "For if I found that I was a person of small consequence, I discovered at the same time that I was more nobly related than I had ever supposed." So how is she nobly related, even though she's a person of small consequence?
She's in the country.
She's what?
She's in America.
She's in America. But there's this new concept of being an American. And I don't know if I've quoted this passage. Yes, I did, on the back. "This George Washington, who died long before I was born, was like a king in greatness, and he and I were fellow citizens." So it's the idea of citizenship that really strikes her. She's sort of overwhelmed by this concept because she's from Russia,
and there are people who are up there, and then there are the little people. So she is not only humbled, but she feels ennobled by learning about George Washington. So there's a paradoxical effect from learning about George Washington. Okay, so she's all of a sudden elevated. She feels very proud as this schoolgirl. But then she also realizes that there are duties that come with this. She says, "It thrilled me to realize what sudden greatness had fallen on me, and at the same time it sobered me as with a sense of responsibility. I strove to conduct myself as befitted a fellow citizen." Okay, so Tocqueville talks about this too, the fact that being a citizen, being equal, prompted people to volunteer to participate in government, especially in local government. Okay, so I think that's very good. However, as you probably know, when you read about education, the things that school children will learn about George Washington and the founding fathers are that they were slaveholders, that they really weren't that great. Maybe there are some other unsavory things about them, but the negatives will be pointed out. And so I was struck by Mary Antin's passage, and I thought, you know, we've lost something when we're not getting this kind of education to our students, especially immigrants who come here, who really don't, aren't born with the sense of citizenship. They may not inherit it from their parents. And so I was alarmed by what I was seeing. A Pew poll in late 2011 said that more young adults between the ages of 18 and 29 had a favorable attitude towards socialism than capitalism. Other people still had a negative view of socialism, but young people favored it over capitalism. Okay, there have been numerous studies showing that students don't have an accurate a good background in history or civics. And so what are we seeing? Okay, I blogged about this. This is an English professor at UC Davis. His name is Nathan Brown, and this is in 2011. And if you, go on the internet and you look at the videos, you can see videos of this. But this was during the Occupy movement. And Nathan Brown teaches in the English department, but he teaches critical theory. If you look at his publications and the courses he teaches, you will notice that he really doesn't have much to do with literature. He's teaching critical theory, which is basically Marxism. And here he is, he's leading a mob of students on the campus of UC Davis. And this was a mob that was agitated because students who had occupied the campus, who would not leave when they were warned, were tear gassed. How many of you remember that? Remember that? Okay. So these students were told, they were given warnings, they were tear gassed, and the professor here rallied these students, and off to the side was the chancellor. And if you see the video, you will notice that she is visibly intimidated. They are basically threatening her. So what's the difference between this kind of a student protest and the protests of the 1960s?
The year.
Okay. Right. So it's still going on. There were radical professors back then, but what I've been noticing is that with these student protests, who's leading them?
The professors,
right? Well, wasn't it during the 60s, the students were protesting against the adults. Now it's the professors leading the students. And this has happened over and over again. In 2009, New York University, there was a protest. These pop up all over the country. Ayers, of course, agitates students for these kinds of protests. Howard Zinn, the late communist historian, actually took students out on protests. And so I thought, okay, well, there's got to be a connection here. Young people like socialism. They've got these professors leading them on these so-called protests. Professors openly are teaching Marxism instead of literature, as they should be. And I was wondering, well, what's happening? Are there any people in the United States who still display that kind of a character that Alexis de Tocqueville was writing about, that's really distinct from the immigrant? Someone asked me recently, she knew about my background and that my parents came from a communist country and that they escaped, literally escaped with me and my father's shoulder crossing the river in the middle of the night. And she said, well, your parents must be very conservative. And I thought about that, and I thought, well, no, they weren't political at all. And then I thought about my friend Metod and his friends, the people he knows in Cleveland. And I thought, no, the way to characterize most of these people is just scared. They're scared. They're scared to talk about their experiences. They have a different mindset. I was thinking, do you ever get one of those emails and you think, oh my God, what was I thinking? I was so insensitive, right? And I was thinking, it's free. You write, it's a free country. You write about whatever you want. But there are people who, are living in this country who were immigrants, and they carried that attitude with them. And I saw it in the parents of my friends. You could just see that different attitude. And I know it's hard for people who kind of were born here and grew up here to know that. And that's part of the purpose of my book. So where is this American character still alive? This character to me is illustrated by a painting by Norman Rockwell called Freedom of Speech. I know it's one of the four freedoms of FDR, which we don't agree with, but nonetheless, this is freedom of speech, so he included that. And to me, this kind of illustrates the character that Tocqueville was talking about. This is a man who is presenting his dissenting opinion, and this is at a town hall. And if you notice, something about him. What do you notice about him? He's a blue collar worker, right? He's a worker. Does that mean he is servile?
In some people's eyes.
In some people's eyes? What about in his own eyes?
In his own eyes, you think he's an equal.
He's an equal.
He believes he's an equal.
Yes, and is he given a platform?
Yeah.
No one's telling him to sit down and shut up, right? No one's saying know your place. He's offering his opinion in a town hall meeting, and that's what Tocqueville talked about. He talked about the local governments and how willing people were to pitch in and to help each other and to run things and to organize things. So this illustrates it. And I was, after seeing Nathan Brown and seeing these students that were just sort of following him, I thought, you're in college. Why are you just following this professor? Anyone remember the Occupy movement? What were they doing when they didn't have microphones? Anybody remember?
They're replaying.
They're replaying it, right? They had the human mic. So someone, the speaker would say a phrase and people would repeat it. Well, one thing I noticed about the protest at UC Davis with Nathan Brown was he had a microphone and the students were still repeating what he was saying. And I thought, how much more brainwashed can you get than to sit there in a mob and just repeat after your professor? You know, the opposite of what this painting illustrates, at least in my eyes, you know, by his posture, by his very dignified stance and other people listening to him. So where are these people? Okay, one of my heroes. This is Becky Gerritsen from the Wetumpka, Alabama Tea Party. This was last June. Anybody remember this hearing? Okay. Probably involved in the Tea Party yourselves, right? Okay, I'm having experience with the IRS myself because, as I said, I filed in February and I'm just getting a stone wall, though they did cash my check for $850 a long time ago. They took that money. But I was struck by what Becky Gerritsen said when she testified before the House Ways and Means Committee about the harassment of her group, which was one of the many, many groups that the IRS is targeting and slowing down the process of getting the applications through for nonprofit status. So she said, "I am not here as a serf or vassal. I am not begging my lords for mercy. I'm a born free American woman, wife, mother, and citizen. And I'm telling my government that you've forgotten your place." Talk about speaking truth to power. That's what the professors like to say. Speak truth to power. She continued, "It's not your responsibility to look out for my well-being and to monitor my speech. It's not your right to assert an agenda. Your post, the post that you occupy, exists to preserve American liberty." Those are stirring words, okay? You serve me. Your role is to preserve liberty. The difference between what happened in Russia and what happened in the West. The Communist Party never really gained that many adherents. Of course, there were spies, there were people spreading the ideas of communism, but as far as the official membership, as Harvey Clare and his colleague point out in their books, it was never that big. And it's because of this attitude. Well, this is changing, I'm afraid. Right. So we get back to Bill Ayers and teaching in the public schools, or specifically in the urban schools. And his tour again. And what he intends to do with it. I've written a book on, I've got a book and these will be for sale, but one is Teaching Revolution, Bill Ayers' Teaching Revolution, because that's what he has spent his career on. And when I read newspaper articles like the one that came out a couple days ago about his talk in Illinois, I get really annoyed because the reporters don't accurately depict what he's doing. Because he's got the doctorate, because he's had tenure, because he's been retired, does not mean that he is a legitimate educator. And about a year ago, even on Fox News, they were relating something about Bill Ayers. I think it was Julia Honeycutt said some, you know, Bill O'Reilly asked her, "Well, what has Bill Ayers been doing since, you know, his terrorist days?" She said, "Oh, well, he was an education professor." And then people leave it at that, okay? Well, he stopped, you know, doing what he was doing in his wild, radical days, and then he became a legitimate education professor. Well, that is not the case. And I think the way to refute him is to not just bring up his terrorist past, but to look at what he has done to education. So I've written a couple reports, several articles, and this guide to his education policies. So if we look at the back of the handout, I've copied a couple quotations just from his syllabi when I did a report for a class called Social Conflicts of the 1960s, which was an honors class, a sophomore level honors class. He said, "In 1965, just as the American catastrophe in Vietnam was reaching full ignition, I was arrested along with 38 others for disrupting the normal operations of the Ann Arbor Draft Board, part of the bureaucratic machinery for sorting soldiers from civilians, the living from the dead, issuing, we thought, warrants to kill and to die." So this is on his syllabus. So what he was using his classes for was to present a version of the 1960s that elevated himself and his fellow weathermen. So even education majors were getting this romanticized view of the 1960s. Okay, he presents the US government as being at fault, as being imperialistic, as invading a country. He continues, the way he characterizes the political leaders, the US political leaders, is that they were blind and arrogant and cocksure as they took over the failed French colonial mission. This is from a syllabus. Okay, syllabus we usually think of as being a document that has the objectives, the schedule, the grade requirements. This is Bill Ayers spinning his story even on his syllabus. He says the US enemy was a poor peasant nation that refused their assigned role in Washington's script. The National Liberation Front wouldn't quit. They retreated when necessary, holed up underground as required, and reemerged suddenly to beat back the invaders. Okay, the invaders, of course, was the US military. We were the invaders. So this is the way Bill Ayers has characterized the United States to generations of future teachers. Okay, what does he think of teaching? What does he think of the education system? Another quote, this was from a graduate seminar for conceptions of teaching and schooling. He says, teachers are cogs and students are prisoners. Okay, this was on a syllabus, and he repeats this in his education books. Okay, students are prisoners, compelled by the state to attend, handed a schedule, a uniform, and a rule book sent to specific designated space of cell blocks monitored constantly. This is not that much different from what the Weather Underground document, Bring the War Home, said. It says young people all over the country go to prisons that are called schools. So basically what Bill Ayers was doing was taking the ideas from the Weather Underground and putting them in his writings on education. And these publications, these writings by Bill Ayers, these articles and books, fill up over 40 pages of a curriculum vitae, or a resume. Okay, so what is this like? Well, remarkably, this is, or unremarkably, this is the same strategy that the communists used in the 1930s. back in 1955 in a book by E. Merrill Root called Collectivism on Campus. He talks about the strategies of the real communists in the 1930s, and he quotes or paraphrases from a 1937 issue of a magazine called The Communist, where the author there writes, "The schools are prisons and class factories which children hate. Communists must incite and augment that hatred. Students must be taught to hate their parents, to rebel against their teachers, to regard elders as enemies, to be filled with contempt for tradition, authority, culture. Every resentment must be exploited," which is exactly what Bill Ayers has been teaching teachers to do in the urban schools, is to exploit every resentment. Okay, so what is Bill Ayers' philosophy? I call it John Dewey or progressivism on steroids. Okay, he believes in a student-centered education where the teacher is not the authority figure, where children are allowed to do what they want to do, but really the teacher is the one directing it, but in a very kind of manipulative way. His philosophy basically can be summed up that education is the motor force of revolution. He said this at an education conference in Venezuela. He went there four times. He said that in front of the late Marxist dictator Hugo Chavez. He said traditional education is evidence of a prison-like system. He's supposed to be a curriculum specialist, but he said that the only curriculum he advocates is one that asks questions like, who am I, where am I going, where have I been, instead of actually teaching students things. Couple other quotes. He says, learning is not linear, it's not incrementally and formally constructed. The best research we have in terms of education is that learning is linear and formally constructed. So if we look at the studies of what works best with low-income and middle-income students, it's the exact opposite of the progressivist education that Bill Ayers advocates. Bill Ayers' education policy is progressivist and actually communist. So what he's doing is actually harming students, and the students that his education philosophy harms the most are the low-income students. Okay, as I've outlined in my book as well, in spite of his crazy ideas, and if you read his educational writings, you'll find that they are nonsensical. I'm convinced that he's been on drugs the whole time, and he's been stoned, and he's just been writing these random thoughts down, quoting radical poets and so forth. He is treated respectfully. I was at a conference in February in Atlanta, and one of his famous lines is, "We are finite beings plunging through infinite space." And the education professors and graduate students applauded him. And actually, during his fireside chat after his keynote speech, there was a student, a graduate student from Baylor University. And we would think, you know, that Baylor would be a bastion of traditionalism. She asked him what could be done, you know, in terms of, you know, sort of beating back the educational system. He said, put your shoulder to the wheel, be disruptive, be subversive. So this is a student from Baylor. Her specialty, and I'm quoting her, was transformative citizenship. This is someone who's getting a graduate degree in education at Baylor University, and tellingly, her specialty is transformative education. Bill Ayers he's still participating in conferences, education conferences, even though he's retired in 2013, April of this year. He participated in 8 different papers and events. His books have a profound influence. So this is my book, This is a book that is widely used in education schools. So future teachers, education majors, are reading this book. This is a book that Bill Ayers wrote in the early 90s, and in 2010, it was made into a graphic book. So you can see what Bill Ayers' philosophy is right there. Okay, the teacher's not teaching, but the student is teaching. You can sort of get a sense of his prose there, seeing the student. The student is teaching the teacher. So authority, tradition, culture, which should be respected, is not, and the teacher is not the authority figure. Liberating the curriculum. He's a curriculum specialist. What does he have to say about the curriculum? Just throw up the book, right? Keeping track, evaluation. Okay, on the left, we see students, they don't look very happy, but I remember my American education in the 1960s, where actually that was a way to learn about being an American. It was not only through the lessons we learned about Christopher Columbus and George Washington, but also in the way we did our schooling. To sit there quietly, obey rules, take turns, study, be rewarded based on merit. That was all part of the inculcation. Yes?
Yeah, the only reason I think that he gets by with stuff like this is because there's a kernel of truth to everything he's saying. Because there's no real falsehood unless there's truth. So in other words, it's not an entity in itself. It has to bounce off something else and recreate it to make it false. Like, you know, if you're a teacher, yeah, the students have a lot of influence. It is kind of a give and take, you know, so that...
Are you a teacher?
I was. I just retired.
Okay. Yeah. Well, that's
so
true.
I'm looking at all this, and that's probably why it's so acceptable, because there's just like a kernel of truth to every little thing he's saying, and he's loading everything onto that. That's what's appealing, I think, to the mass, you know, the young students coming up in the teaching profession. Just like if you don't really take the big picture view of things and understand what's going on, you know, you miss it, you get sucked into that.
Yeah, well, that's a very good point. And I think you're absolutely right, because, you know, especially, you know, having a picture of students like that, you know, having a teacher who's, you know, too much of it, of an authoritarian, and is just too rigid and too pedantic, it doesn't encourage learning either. Of course, there's got to be a mixture, but he takes it to the extreme, right? And if you actually, I don't know if you've read what he's written about education, but he actually advocates chaos in the classroom. He likes it when there's disorder. He says the only requirement for teaching is love. I mean, he goes to the extreme, and so he creates disorder. And that is appealing, and it's especially appealing, say, to students who maybe come from a background where, you know, they come from a poor background. This might be appealing. Oh, this is a loving teacher who just wants to make sure his students have fun and they're going to learn and so forth. But this is very, you know, in the way he presents it, it's very subversive. But that was an excellent point. Okay, so as I wrap up, I just want to talk a little bit about what Bill Ayers is doing since he supposedly disappeared from the scene in 2008, right? He was just supposed to be some guy who lived down the street from Barack Obama, and Barack Obama said he was an English professor or something. He didn't even know what he taught. My late friend Larry Grathwall, who wrote Bringing Down America, that Professor Coulter mentioned, believes that they knew each other since the early 1980s. And he told me some choice words he had for Bill Ayers, because he describes him very aptly in this book. Bill Ayers comes across as this pompous little guy who was the education secretary in the Weathermen, who liked to boss other people around. Even when it came to setting bombs, he would just sort of order people around, tell them, when they could have monogamous relationships and so forth. Because one of the objectives of the Weathermen was, of course, to smash monogamy. So Bill Ayers was actually giving people orders in that respect, their private lives. What's that?
A true communist.
A true communist. Yeah, you break down the sense of authority, family, respect for the government, respect for citizenship. Anybody recognize this person? Okay, this is Linda Darling Hammond. And Bill Ayers calls her his closest colleague or closest associate. She's a Stanford education professor, and she was the head of Obama's education transition team. She is in charge of developing one of the two tests that will be administered under the federal program called Common Core. She is on the same page as Bill Ayers philosophically, and I've read several of her articles. And by the way these people get these curricula vitae that are 45 pages long, they just repeat themselves. So I've been reading her articles, and she's basically on the same page as Bill Ayers. She didn't set any bombs, so she doesn't have that in her background. But they've published each other's work, they've been to the same conferences, etc. Okay, other connections. Bill Ayers, if you go to his blog, will say that these right-wing extremists, or that he was confronted by a blogger in 2009 who asked him, "Did you really write Dreams from My Father?" Everybody heard that?
Yeah.
Bill Ayers supposedly wrote that. Okay,
Jack.
Huh? Obama's book, right.
Bill Ayers wrote it. The only thing he didn't do, I think, was the punctuation marks. If you read other Bill Ayers books,
yeah.
It follows all of his Bill Ayers books and all his essays and his curriculum.
Yeah, well, that's right. There's the same philosophical outlook. The style is very similar.
Well, there's one thing about communists that we all know is they come out with nothing new. What was written by Marx and Engels and the rest of them is the same thing that they talk about today, write about today. They just changed the dates.
Well, that's true. They're using the same strategies, and I tried to show that by just one example, of the communist magazine saying in 1937 that schools are prisons, and Bill Ayers today saying that schools are prisons, or whenever he was writing his articles. Well, at this 2009 conference, he mentions it on his self-serving blog post, and he kind of dismisses it. Well, why was Bill Ayers in Washington, D.C. to confront this blogger? Well, Bill Ayers was traveling from a conference that he had attended along with Education Secretary Arne Duncan, Under Secretary Martha Cantor, and a representative from Achieve, that is that far-left nonprofit group that's putting together Common Core. Why was he there? I thought they really didn't have anything to do with each other. And this last April at the American Educational Research Association conference, Darling Hammond was there. She participated in a presidential session. Bill Ayers was there. He participated in 8 different activities. He had a paper on teaching at Occupy Wall Street encampments, which is what he did during the Occupy Wall Street movement. And it's a paper called Occupy This, Occupy That, Occupy Everything. So he was using his teaching skills in retirement for Occupy Wall Street. He also co-authored a paper in memoriam Hugo Chavez with Peter McLaren. But at the same conference was Arne Duncan. So most likely Bill Ayers was in the audience listening to Arne Duncan's keynote speech. And Arne Duncan was promising these teachers, these professors who hate testing, that he would be making new assessments of children's non-cognitive skills. So what are non-cognitive skills?
Reading, writing, arithmetic.
Well, those are cognitive. The non-cognitive...
You don't treat them as non-cognitive.
Okay, well, non-cognitive implies attitudes, right? Your emotions, and so forth. So this is the new kind of testing or assessment. Okay, this is just Peter McLaren, who co-wrote the paper with Bill Ayers. Arne Duncan, as you recognize him. Okay, and finally, this is an original oil portrait of Bill Ayers that he's been using. This was a portrait that was painted for this nonprofit project called Americans Who Tell the Truth.
Looks okay. Like Norman Rockwell.
Norman Rockwell, yeah. And there's actually writing here. There is, after all, the basis for education in a democracy, or something. It's probably something that he wrote. So there he is, Bill Ayers, very contemplative. Americans Who Tell the Truth is Americans like Howard Zinn, Medea Benjamin of Code Pink. And this is artwork and a curriculum that's going into schools, K through 12 schools. And Bill Ayers writes his own version of the 1960s and his role in it, similar to what you saw on the syllabus. So this is what's being taught to some children in schools. Okay, so anyway, what are the similarities between the Department of Education and Bill Ayers' teaching philosophy? They do not believe in traditional education, which is what works, the teacher-centered or education. It's a very progressive form of education. There's no understanding of American citizenship. That's being taken away. And citizens are being turned into subjects, maybe modern-day peasants, people who follow leaders, and are compliant workers. And what I see is the elimination of the American character. So what can we do? Bill Ayers is going to be speaking in a couple days at a publicly funded college in Illinois. I think it's appropriate, as one couple who are alumni of that college from 1955, to write letters to the editor and mention his past as a domestic terrorist, and that he really shouldn't have a forum, he should be in jail, which I agree with. But I think another strategy is to point out that he really is a fraud as far as education goes. And the purpose of his education policy is to turn American citizens into subjects, or people that have not been known in the United States before, American peasants. An American peasant is an oxymoron. So anyway, as part of my own project, I published a couple other books. This was a book I co-authored with a history professor, because I saw in my Norton anthology for a writing class that Barack Obama's Cairo speech in 2009 was reprinted with all the historical errors intact, with the introductory material just praising the speech. And then I noticed that just about every English anthology or textbook that for college classes, whether it was freshman composition or advanced composition, had something by Barack Obama. All of a sudden, he's this great literary figure. Okay, maybe George Washington's farewell address is not in there, but Barack Obama's speeches are, because overnight he is this great figure of rhetoric. And here's another anthology that I've put together, I've edited, and I got about six colleagues to contribute essays. Some of them are sad, some of them are funny, but I can never even remember my own title. But this is called Exiled, Stories from Conservative and Moderate Professors Who Have Been Ridiculed, Ostracized, Marginalized, Demonized, and Frozen Out. So anyway, that is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for listening and participating. They were going to work to transform the government of the United States into a participatory democracy, or as some people would call it, a Soviet democracy. It's the kind of democracy that James Madison warned about in Federalist Number 10. He said these kinds of democracies have been short-lived and violent, if you read history. So they were going to do this by infiltrating the universities and by making political life an adjunct to the academic life. Okay, and the academic life has traditionally been one that has been the pursuit of knowledge for its own sake. So as a result of what this generation did by coming into the universities, gaining tenure, hiring people who agree with them, is to make academics into activism. So today we have professors who will openly advertise themselves as activists on their websites at public universities. And Bill Ayers is, one of the people who is doing this, and he is very influential because he has been training generations of teachers. The school that Bill Ayers teaches at is the University of Illinois at Chicago, which specializes in training teachers for urban schools. So what they were trying to do, as they said in Prairie Fire, which is to go and find those people who are discontented and to organize them, is he's been training teachers to go into these schools. Okay, why are they doing this? Well, why didn't communism ever catch on in the United States? The person who ran the program I was teaching at Emory, Harvey Clare, talks about, or he writes about communism, that's his focus, American communism. Why didn't communism catch on in the United States? I mean, there's always, there's been the Communist Party since 1919, but it was just a very tiny percentage.
Because of our Judeo-Christian foundation, maybe?
Yes. A big part of it. And the first thing the communists did when they took over was, of course, to kill the priests and nuns and to kill the ministers, right? Because that interferes with their objectives. Richard Pipes, who is the Russian historian, writes that Russia lacked the deterrence to social revolution, and as he's going through the history of Russia, present in the West, which is respect for law and property, along with a sense of allegiance to a state that protected liberty and provided social services. And I have this quote as the second quote on the handout. The Russian radical intelligentsia, permeated with utopian idealism on the one hand and a peasantry bent on seizing private land on the other, created a state of permanent tension liable to explode anytime the central government found itself in trouble. Okay, so you have a radical intelligentsia and a peasantry. People who are discontent, who are maybe not literate, who resent the property that others have in a government that doesn't protect property. So what better way to form this than to, you know, find those people and go to the schools and find them? Okay, so we have the radical intelligentsia, the academics, and the peasantry. And when I would talk about the peasants, which is the class that my parents came from, my students didn't know what that meant. And I've copied the dictionary definition on the handout. And the dictionary, the American Heritage College Dictionary, says a peasant is a member of the class comprising small farmers and tenants, sharecroppers and laborers on the land, a country person, a rustic and uncouth, crude, or ill-bred person, a boor. Okay, but that doesn't capture it. And Tocqueville understood that. Most people don't know what a peasant is. When I would ask my students, they said, what is a peasant? Well, Tocqueville said, the Americans never use the word peasant because they have no idea of the class which that term denotes. Okay, so in 1830, 1831, the Frenchman, the French aristocrat, Alexis de Tocqueville, is traveling across the United States, and he makes this observation, Americans don't know what the peasant is. Okay, why don't they know what the peasant is? There must be something more to being a peasant than just being a farm laborer or being an uncouth person, an uneducated person. Well, being a peasant implies that it's a social class that you cannot leave. So in Europe, there were peasants. In America, there were not any peasants. In America, there were servants and masters, but the servants and the masters treated each other respectfully, because the master knew that at any time the servant might become his master. There was the condition of equality in the United States. So that's one observation that Alexis de Tocqueville makes. And as I've been doing some reading making notes for my book, I remember a short story by Anthony Bukowski, who is a first generation Polish writer. I think he recently retired from teaching English. And he writes a short story that captures that essence of people who just feel helpless to do anything about their situation. Their daughter and sister is seduced. They can't do anything. They have this mindset that they are peasants. Okay, so what other things does Tocqueville have to say about character? As he goes on talking about peasants, this is in volume two, he says, you know, the closest that might come to a peasant might be the person who goes out into the woods and builds a log cabin. But is this person like a peasant? He may live in this very primitive structure where you can see daylight through the boards, but this person is not like a peasant. He is literate. He knows about the past. He knows about the present, and he can debate politics with you. And he says that this pioneer, this American pioneer, knows his rights. He goes into the woods, he strikes out for the wilderness and settles it, and he carries with him three things: the Bible, an axe, and some newspapers. So he is very well informed, and you can have a conversation with this guy, and he knows more than the French intellectuals. So there's something about the character A peasant would not be able to do this. Okay, so I noticed that, and so I'm going to be drawing on Tocqueville quite a bit because I think he has a lot to say about the American character. There's also someone else by the name of Mary Anton who wrote a book in 1912 called The Promised Land. Anybody heard of Mary Anton? You have, great, great. I think she's in some anthologies, she's in an English class, maybe? Okay. Mary Anton, which was not her original name in Russian, was an immigrant as a girl, and she came over to the United States, obviously, I think her mother came to meet her father. But I was struck by a passage from her autobiography. She writes about George Washington, and she writes, "But a human being, strictly good, perfectly wise, and unfailingly valiant, all at the same time, I had never heard or dreamed of." Here she is trying to recreate her experience as a girl in a public school. And she continues, "This wonderful George Washington was as inimitable as he was irreproachable. Even if I had never, never told a lie, I could not compare myself to George Washington, for I was not brave. I was afraid to go out when snowballs whizzed, and I could never be the first president of the United States." Well, obviously, George Washington was, right? How many of you, when you were first exposed to George Washington, learned about him and the cherry tree? Okay, well, that's good, okay? That's what I learned, that George Washington could not even tell a lie to his father, which I think is a great thing to teach young children because he was the first president. And I think children need to have heroes. And I'll continue on with what Mary Anton writes. So obviously she's recreating this experience of this man who is on a pedestal, right? This larger than life figure, this almost godlike person. She continues, "The twin of my newborn humility, paradoxical as it may seem, was a sense of dignity I had never known before." So even though he's up on a pedestal, she's getting a sense of dignity. She continues, "For if I found that I was a person of small consequence, I discovered at the same time that I was more nobly related than I had ever supposed." So how is she nobly related, even though she's a person of small consequence?
She's in the country.
She's what?
She's in America.
But there's this new concept of being an American. And I don't know if I've quoted this passage. Yes, I did, on the back. "This George Washington, who died long before I was born, was like a king in greatness, and he and I were fellow citizens." So it's the idea of citizenship that really strikes her. She's sort of overwhelmed by this concept because she's from Russia, and there are people who are up there, and then there are the little people. So she is not only humbled, but she feels ennobled by learning urban schools. And his tour again, and what he intends to do with it. I've written a book on, well anyway, I've got a book and these will be for sale, but one is Teaching Revolution, Bill Ayers' Teaching Revolution, because that's what he has spent his career on. And when I read newspaper articles like the one that came out a couple days ago about his talk in Illinois, I get really annoyed because the reporters don't accurately depict what he's doing, because he's got the doctorate, because he's had tenure, because he's been retired, does not mean that he is a legitimate educator. And about a year ago, even on Fox News, they were relating something about Bill Ayers. I think it was Julia Honeycutt said some, you know, Bill O'Reilly asked her, well, what has Bill Ayers been doing since, you know, his terrorist days? She said, oh, well, he was an education professor. And then people leave it at that, okay? Well, he stopped, you know, doing what he was doing in his wild, radical days, and then he became a legitimate education professor. Well, that is not the case. And I think the way to refute him is to not just bring up his terrorist past, but to look at what he has done to education. So I've written a couple reports, several articles, and this guide to his education policies. So if we look at the back of the handout, I've copied a couple quotations just from his syllabi when I did a report for a class called Social Conflicts of the 1960s, which was an honors class, a sophomore level honors class. He said, in 1965, just as the American catastrophe in Vietnam was reaching full ignition, I was arrested along with 38 others for disrupting the normal operations of the Ann Arbor Draft Board, part of the bureaucratic machinery for sorting soldiers from civilians, the living from the dead, issuing, we thought, warrants to kill and to die. So this is on his syllabus. So what he was using his classes for was to present a version of the 1960s that elevated himself and his fellow weathermen. So even education majors were getting this romanticized view of the 1960s. Okay, he presents the US government as being at fault, as being imperialistic, as invading a country. He continues the way he characterizes the political leaders, the U.S. political leaders, is that they were blind and arrogant and cocksure as they took over the failed French colonial mission. This is from a syllabus. Okay, syllabus we usually think of as being a document that has the objectives, the schedule, the grade requirements. This is Bill Ayers spinning his story even on his syllabus. He says the U.S. enemy was a poor peasant nation that refused their assigned role in Washington's script. The National Liberation Front wouldn't quit. They retreated when necessary, holed up underground as required, and reemerged suddenly to beat back the invaders. Okay, the invaders, of course, was the U.S. military. We were the invaders. So this is the way Bill Ayers has characterized the United States to generations of future teachers. Okay, what does he think of teaching? What does he think of the education system? Another quote, this was from a graduate seminar for Conceptions of Teaching and Schooling. He says, teachers are cogs, and students are prisoners. Okay, this was on a syllabus, and he repeats this in his education books. Okay, students are prisoners, compelled by the state to attend, handed a schedule, a uniform, and a rule book sent to specific designated space of cell blocks monitored constantly. This is not that much different from what the Weather Underground document Bring the War Home said. says young people all over the country go to prisons that are called schools. So basically what Bill Ayers was doing was taking the ideas from the Weather Underground and putting them in his writings on education. And these publications, these writings by Bill Ayers, these articles and books, fill up over 40 pages of a curriculum vitae, or a resume. Okay, so what is this like? Well, remarkably, this is the same strategy that the communists used in the 1930s. Back in 1955, in a book by E. Merrill Root called Collectivism on Campus, he talks about the strategies of the real communists in the 1930s, and he quotes or paraphrases from a 1937 issue of a magazine called The Communist, where the author there writes, "The schools are prisons and class factories which children hate. Communists must incite and augment that hatred. Students must be taught to hate their parents, to rebel against their teachers, to regard elders as enemies, to be filled with contempt for tradition, authority, culture. Every resentment must be exploited," which is exactly what Bill Ayers has been teaching teachers to do in the urban schools, is to exploit every resentment. Okay, so what is Bill Ayers' philosophy? I call it John Dewey or progressivism on steroids. Okay, he believes in a student-centered education where the teacher is not the authority figure, where children are allowed to do what they want to do, but really the teacher is the one directing it, but in a very kind of manipulative way. His philosophy basically can be summed up that education is the motor force of revolution. He said this at an education conference in Venezuela. He went there 4 times. He said that in front of the late Marxist dictator Hugo Chavez. He said traditional education is evidence of a prison-like system. He's supposed to be a curriculum specialist, but he said that the only curriculum he advocates is one that asks questions like, who am I, where am I going, where have I been, instead of actually teaching students things. Couple other quotes. He says, learning is not linear, it's not incrementally and formally constructed. The best research we have in terms of education is that learning is linear and formally constructed. So if we look at the studies of what works best with low-income and middle-income students, it's the exact opposite of the progressivist education that Bill Ayers advocates. Bill Ayers' education policy is progressivist and actually communist. So what he's doing is actually harming students, and the students that his education philosophy harms the most are the low-income students. Okay, as I've outlined in my book as well, in spite of his crazy ideas, and if you read his educational writings, you'll find that they are nonsensical. I'm convinced that he's been on drugs the whole time, and he's been stoned, and he's just been writing these random thoughts down, quoting radical poets and so forth. He is treated respectfully. I was at a conference in February in Atlanta, and one of his famous lines is, "We are finite beings plunging through infinite space." And the education professors and graduate students applauded him. And actually, during his fireside chat after his keynote speech, there was a student, a graduate student from Baylor University. And we would think, you know, that Baylor would be a bastion of traditionalism. She asked him what could be done, in terms of, you know, sort of beating back the educational system. He said, put your shoulder to the wheel, be disruptive, be subversive. So this is a student from Baylor. Her specialty, and I'm quoting her, was transformative citizenship. This is someone who's getting a graduate degree in education at Baylor University, and tellingly, her specialty is transformative education. Bill Ayers he's still participating in conferences, education conferences, even though he's retired in 2013, April of this year. He participated in 8 different papers and events. His books have a profound influence. So this is my book. This is a book that is widely used in education schools. So future teachers, education majors, are reading this book. This is a book that Bill Ayers wrote in the early 90s, and in 2010, it was made into a graphic book. So you can see what Bill Ayers' philosophy is right there. Okay, the teacher's not teaching, but the student is teaching. You can sort of get a sense of his prose there, seeing the student. The student is teaching the teacher. So authority, tradition, culture, which should be respected, is not, and the teacher is not the authority figure. Liberating the curriculum. He's a curriculum specialist. What does he have to say about the curriculum? Just throw up the book, right? Keeping track, evaluation. Okay, on the left, we see students, they don't look very happy, but I remember my American education in the 1960s, where actually that was a way to learn about being an American. It was not only through the lessons we learned about Christopher Columbus and George Washington, but also in the way we did our schooling. To sit there quietly, obey rules, take turns, study, be rewarded based on merit. That was all part of the inculcation. Yes?
Yeah, the only reason I think that he gets by with stuff like this is because there's a kernel of truth to everything he's saying. Because there's no real falsehood unless there's truth. So in other words, it's not an entity in itself. It has to bounce off something else and recreate it.
Is that better? Can you hear me? Okay. Okay, so about the college ethos that we have, which is we believe in the democratic process, and we invite all our friends who are liberals, progressives, as long as you believe in the democratic process, we're glad to meet and talk with people. So we're glad you're here. I want to say, before I introduce also Dr. Grabar, that I was reading a book that was not, I want to make clear, not written by Dr. Grabar. It was called Bringing Down America, and it's about an FBI agent who infiltrated the Weatherman Group that she will talk about. And while the book, it was published originally in 76, republished last year with a new foreword, and this man, Grathwall, he died this year, and I think we owe him a great deal because he was a sacrificial contributor to America, and he was a good man. So I just wanted to mention that at the outset. So Dr. Grabar is a person that I first saw published on my favorite website, which is townhall.com. And of course, everybody has a place where they just want to start the day and read news with like-minded people. So townhall.com is my favorite. It's got a lot of big shots on there, and Mary is right among them. She is also published with Front Page Magazine, which is written by David Horowitz. And if you've ever heard of Horowitz, you know that he used to be a hardcore lefty in the 60s, but he saw the light and he became a patriot, and he's very well known in the academic community. And Dr. Grabar has been to a lot of conferences, done a lot of speaking, and so I'm just going to let her take over. Glad to have you.
Thank you. Did you want to?
Yeah, that's what you said.
Okay. It's good to be here, and I really, am I speaking into this microphone or this one right here? Okay. Can everybody hear me? Okay, great. I've been teaching for 20 years, and this is the first time I'm not teaching this year. I was teaching in a program called the Program in American Democracy and Citizenship at Emory University. It was funded by a private grant, and it was not refunded this year. So I was telling people where I was speaking, it felt really odd in August not to have to prepare a syllabus. I was like, what am I going to do with myself? But anyway, that gives me more time to write and to speak to people. I've been speaking to some Tea Party groups throughout Georgia. Can you hear me? Okay. And he always gives me material. I've been tracking him since about 2008, and when he came into the news, and he's one of the people, I might get in trouble for this, but he's in my target. and he deserves to be. He's one of those radicals in education that I see as destroying our youth. He is a bad person. I'm also working on a book at the present time. I've got this nonprofit that I've started. I'm still waiting to hear from the IRS. I applied in February. I have this nonprofit called Dissident Prof Education Project, where I do these projects. But I'm working on a book right now. And it's about the American character. And what I'm doing is I'm using my own experiences as an immigrant. I know I don't sound like an immigrant, but I am an immigrant. I came here when I was 2 years old. My parents brought me from communist Yugoslavia at the time. I'll reveal my age here. I think that was 1958. Okay, it was very much communist then. And I used to talk about this with my students at Emory when I was teaching there, and talk about Yugoslavia. Well, this is a map of Cold War Europe, and you can see where Yugoslavia was. It was ruled by Marshal Tito, so it wasn't wasn't part of the Soviet pact, but it was communist nonetheless. So Slovenia, where's the thing for that? So Slovenia gained independence, broke away in 1991, and I would ask my students if they knew where Slovenia was. And they didn't. They hadn't heard of it. How many of you have heard of Slovenia? Okay, some have. Okay, those of you who haven't, don't feel bad because George W. Bush didn't know where it was, or he mistook it for Slovakia. But this is where Slovenia is now. It was the northernmost republic of the communist Yugoslavia. And so it's that tiny little green, dark green country there that's bordered by on the west by Italy, on the north by Austria, and on the east by Hungary. And my parents, like many people, had to escape in the middle of the night to leave Yugoslavia because they had to get past the border guards, and they spent a year as refugees in Austria. And a lot of people don't know about that. And so what I want to do is to sort of, talk about my experiences. So my book's going to be part memoir and part analysis of the American character. So this is the country I'm from. And if we want to look at, how big Slovenia is in comparison to the United States, there it is. It's about the size of New Jersey. It's got a population of slightly over 2 million people. There are actually more Slovenians living abroad than live there. Largest concentration is in Cleveland, and you will know more about Slovenia than you ever hope to. And the reason I point out the size of this is because throughout Slovenia, this tiny country, the size of New Jersey, there are over 600 unmarked mass graves. These are people who resisted the communist takeover. And some of them were sent back from Austria in 1945. They thought they were going someplace else, but they were released back, and the partisans, as they were called, what they did is they just took men, women, and children, rounded them up in these big pits, and just shot them. So just imagine a state like New Jersey having 600 unmarked graves, mass graves, where there are men, women, and children. And you come across a farmer, a poor farmer, who might, he would be in his 80s now, but who might remember this massacre, but he's too afraid to speak about it to this present day. Okay, so Slovenia is supposed to have a parliamentary government now. I've talked to some older Slovenians from there, and they say, well, the Reds are still in there. Okay, so this is a country that still has these unmarked graves. And of late, I've been thinking about character. As I was teaching at Emory, I was teaching Alexis de Tocqueville, Democracy in America, one of my favorite books. How many of you have read Democracy in America or passages from it? Okay, good. Whenever I open that up, it's like, oh yes, I can see what he's talking about. It's still going on today. And I thought, you know, and I thought, wow, you know, I'm seeing this, and I'm wondering if people who grew up here and didn't grow up in immigrant families can see what he's seeing. And so I wanted to talk about the difference in character and what it was like for people of my parents' generation who came here. And at a conference in 2008 of the Slavic Studies Association, which is based in Cleveland, of course, I think, I met this man named Metod Milac, who was a survivor. He was a college student. He was captured by both the Nazis and the communists. And he spent some time at Auschwitz in the labor camp, not in the concentration camp. He escaped, and he was one of those displaced persons after World War II who came to the United States seeking refuge, and he built a life here, as many did. And these displaced persons have always fascinated me. I kind of grew up with the children of them, and I noticed, you know, there were certain characteristics that they had. Well, anyway, recently, as I was at a conference, I thought, gee, no one knows their stories. How many of you had heard of displaced persons? Okay. So yeah, about half of you know, but a lot of people don't know about them and their experiences. And so I wrote an email to my friend. He's written a couple books about his experiences, and I said, I have this idea. I'd like to edit a collection of writings by these people or stories by these people. And he wrote back this kind of heartbreaking email. And he said, I know a lot of people, but they will not talk to you. They are still afraid to talk about this. Okay, they have relatives there, and they're afraid for the relatives in Slovenia what's going to happen to them. So there is still this fear, and there's this there's a different character that I've noticed among people who came from Eastern and Central Europe and their children,
their children inherited certain attitudes between them and people who grew up in America, who grew up in the United States. And where does this come from? Well, I think it comes from our educational system. So my book is going to be titled An American Education. And who is one of these people who's changing the character? Bill Ayers. Okay. And I just realized, or I learned, that there was a question on Jeopardy about Bill Ayers. As Bill Ayers was in a 60s radical group called this, maybe he forecast later being an Illinois education professor. So what was this group? Buddy, no. Weather Underground, right. It was the Weathermen initially, until they had to be fugitives from the law, but it was the Weathermen. And Michelle Malkin and some other conservatives complained that you know, that college students were now being required to know about Bill Ayers. One of the things they didn't like was the fact that he was just characterized as being in a radical group, and that then he was an education professor, which he was. So, Bill Ayers, as I said, is giving me a lot of work to do of late. And I thought, well, students should know who Bill Ayers is. And I would ask my students at Emory if they knew who he was, and he came into the news in 2008. And I know you college students probably were, what, 13, 14 at the time of the 2008 election, paying attention to politics, probably not that much. But I felt the students should know who he is because he's doing the college circuit speaking tour again. He is going to be speaking in a couple days on Thursday at Elgin Community College in Illinois. And so he has been asked to speak there. And he's going to be talking about his new book, I think in part, which is titled Public Enemy: Confessions of an American Dissident. Okay, so who is Bill Ayers? Is he just a radical, or did he just belong to a radical group and protest the Vietnam War? Is he a legitimate education professor? Is he someone who has a respectable position and has done respectable work? Well, this is a picture of Bill Ayers. Okay, as you can see, this is not a young man, you know, in the height of his youthful idealism, but this is a man in his late 50s, and this is a posed picture, and this is the picture that was sent out with the publication of his book called Fugitive Days. That was his first memoir. Now he's coming out next month with a sequel to that memoir. And here he is deliberately posing on a flag for the release of this book. However, Bill Ayers, if we look on the handout, the first passage I've quoted, and this is a blog post from about last week, this is what he writes. In the heat of the 2008 presidential election, Barack Obama's opponents were spinning a chilling narrative that cast him as an enigmatic figure with a group of shadowy associates, including a black nationalist preacher, that would be Jeremiah Wright, a Palestinian professor, and an unrepentant domestic terrorist. So he's speaking about himself in the third person if he wrote this. That imagined terrorist was Bill Ayers, a one-time leader of the Weather Underground. The McCain campaign spent millions of dollars demonizing Ayers, specifically in castigating Senator Obama for Sarah Palin's deathless phrase, palling around with terrorists. Okay, this is how he's characterizing himself, and this is the way he's going to be characterizing himself as he's speaking at community college campuses in these forums on the humanities. So is that an accurate representation of his history? Well, here are some FBI posters. This one on the far left is of Bill Ayers, Kathy Boudin, and Judith Clark, and Bernadine Dorn on the far right. Bernadine Dorn became his wife. So, what is Bill Ayers' real history? He was a leader of the Weather Underground. This was a domestic terrorist group. He participated in the bombings of the New York City Police Headquarters in 1970, the Capitol Building in 1971, and the Pentagon in 1972. And of course, he worked as an education professor. That is true. He did have that position from 1987 to 2010. Bill Ayers was born in 1944, and he was raised in an affluent Chicago suburb. His father was Thomas Ayers, who was an influential person politically. He was the chair of Con Edison there. But Bill Ayers became radicalized in his teenage years, as he writes about in Fugitive Days. In the mid-1960s, he taught at a radical alternative school, part of the free school movement. This was a place where students addressed their teachers by their first name. And he brags in Fugitive Days that I walked out of jail and into my first teaching job. So this is something he brags about. By the age of 21, he was the director of that school. In 1968, he earned a BA in American Studies from the University of Michigan. In the late 1960s, Bill Ayers and Bernadine Dorn co-founded the Weathermen, which became the Weather Underground. This was a splinter of SDS. Anybody know who the SDS was? Students for a Democratic Society. Right, it was a group that was organized by the socialist Al Haber in 1960. So, Bernadine Dorn and Bill Ayers thought that the tactics of the Students for a Democratic Society weren't radical enough, and they advocated using violence. Okay, in 1969 at the University of Oregon, Ayers boasted of the Students for a Democratic Society role in the Venceremos Brigades, a project that was initiated by the Cuban government, where these students or these young adults went to Cuba. Excuse me. They were supposed to be working in the fields, but they were actually training in guerrilla warfare. In 1969, Ayers was a participant in the 1969 Days of Rage riots in Chicago, and there were 300 members of the organization. They committed acts of violence, arson, and attacks against police and civilians alike. They called the police pigs. Ayers refers to the police as pigs in his memoir, Fugitive Days. Their long-term goal, however, was to cause the collapse of the United States. Bill Ayers, as you can see in that blog post, denies that he was ever a terrorist. Thank you. But if you just read Fugitive Days, you will see several passages where he admits to participating in bombings. They bombed the city police headquarters in New York, as I said, the Capitol, the Pentagon. And on one page, Bill Ayers even writes, everything was absolutely ideal. The sky was blue, the birds were singing, and the bastards were finally going to get what was coming to them. And this is what he says about the day that they bombed the Pentagon. Okay, so Ayers and the Weather Underground were responsible for 30 bombings aimed at destroying the defense and security infrastructure of the U.S. Bill Ayers famously, on September 11, 2001, in a New York Times interview, said that I don't regret setting bombs. And he said, I didn't feel we did enough. And then in his memoir, he also wrote, I can't imagine dismissing the possibility of doing it again. In 1970, a bomb that was intended for Fort Dix, where American soldiers were going to be attending a dance with their dates, accidentally went off in a Greenwich Village townhouse, killing three members of the Weathermen, including Diana Otten, who was Bill Ayers' girlfriend at the time. And while they were on the run, Bill Ayers co-authored this document called Prairie Fire, The Politics of Revolutionary Anti-Imperialism. And just a couple of quotes. For more evidence that he was involved in terroristic activities, they said, we are a guerrilla organization. We are communist women and men, deeply affected by the historic events of our time and the struggle against U.S. imperialism. Our intention is to disrupt the empire, to incapacitate it, to put pressure on the cracks. And finally, our job is to tap the discontent seething in many sectors of the population to find allies everywhere. People are hungry or angry, to mobilize poor and working people against imperialism. Okay, so how was he going to find people who are discontented? Well, in 1980, Bill Ayers and Bernadine Dorn emerged from hiding, and they were let off because of an FBI oversight. And so the charges against them were dropped because of this technicality. And Bill Ayers famously said that he was guilty as a bird. Guilty as sin, free as a bird, America is a great country. Bill Ayers then immediately went on and earned a master's and then a doctorate in education. The doctorate was from Columbia. He immediately got a job at the University of Illinois in Chicago, rose up the academic ladder and gained tenure, and then became a distinguished professor. Okay, so what is Bill Ayers' objective in education? Okay, so basically, his influences, as he notes them in his memoir and his writings, are Ho Chi Minh, Che Guevara, communists. He refers to these. Bill Ayers was doing what the SDS was doing and what they said they were going to do in their manifesto called the Port Huron Statement. And they were going to change the strategy, and this is what Bill Ayers did in the 1980s and onward. He didn't bring down the U.S. government through bombings. He realized he couldn't do that, so he went into education. And he basically followed what the SDS said they were going to do in their meeting in 1962. They were the new left, and they were going to reject the old style communist strategies and think about George Washington. So there's a paradoxical effect from learning about George Washington. Okay, so she's all of a sudden elevated. She feels very proud as this schoolgirl. But then she also realizes that there are duties that come with this. She says, "It thrilled me to realize what sudden greatness had fallen on me, and at the same time it sobered me as with a sense of responsibility. I strove to conduct myself as befitted a fellow citizen." Okay, so Tocqueville talks about this too, the fact that being a citizen, being equal, prompted people to volunteer to participate in government, especially in local government. Okay, so I think that's very good. However, as you probably know, when you read about education, the things that school children will learn about George Washington and the Founding Fathers are that they were slaveholders, that they really weren't that great. Maybe there are some other unsavory things about them, but the negatives will be pointed out. And so I was struck by Mary Anton's passage, and I thought, you know, we've lost something when we're not getting this kind of education to our students, especially immigrants who come here, who really don't, aren't born with the sense of citizenship. They may not inherit it from their parents. And so I was alarmed by what I was seeing. A Pew poll in late 2011 said that more young adults between the ages of 18 and 29 had a favorable attitude towards socialism than capitalism. Other people still had a negative view of socialism, but young people favored it over capitalism. Okay, there have been numerous studies showing that students don't have an accurate a good background in history or civics. And so what are we seeing? Okay, I blogged about this. This is an English professor at UC Davis. His name is Nathan Brown, and this is in 2011. And if you, go on the internet and you look at the videos, you can see videos of this. But this was during the Occupy movement. And Nathan Brown teaches in the English department, but he teaches critical theory. If you look at his publications and the courses he teaches, you will notice that he really doesn't have much to do with literature. He's teaching critical theory, which is basically Marxism. And here he is, he's leading a mob of students on the campus of UC Davis. And this was a mob that was agitated because students who had occupied the campus, who would not leave when they were warned, were tear gassed. How many of you remember that? Remember that? Okay. So these students were told, they were given warnings, they were tear gassed, and the professor here rallied these students, and off to the side was the chancellor. And if you see the video, you will notice that she is visibly intimidated. They are basically threatening her. So what's the difference between this kind of a student protest and the protests of the 1960s?
The year.
Okay. Right. So it's still going on. There were radical professors back then. But what I've been noticing is that with these student protests, who's leading them?
The professors,
right? Well, wasn't it during the 60s, the students were protesting against the adults. Now it's the professors leading the students. And this has happened over and over again. In 2009, New York University, there was a protest. These just pop up all over the country. Ayers, of course, agitates students for these kinds of protests. Howard Zinn, the late communist historian, actually took students out on protests. And so I thought, okay, well, there's got to be a connection here. You know, young people like socialism. They've got these professors leading them on these so-called protests. Professors openly are teaching Marxism instead of literature, as they should be. And I was wondering, well, what's happening? Are there any people in the United States who still display that kind of a character that Alexis de Tocqueville was writing about, that's really distinct from the immigrant? Someone asked me recently, she knew about my background and that my parents came from a communist country and that they escaped, literally escaped, with me and my father's shoulder crossing the river in the middle of the night. And she said, well, your parents must be very conservative. And I thought about that, and I thought, well, no, they weren't political at all. And then I thought about my friend Metod and his friends, the people he knows in Cleveland. And I thought, no, the way to characterize most of these people is just scared. They're scared. They're scared to talk about their experiences. They have a different mindset. You know, me, you know, I was thinking, you know, do you ever get one of those emails and you think, oh my God, what was I thinking? I was so insensitive, right? And I was thinking, you know, it's free, you write, you know, it's a free country, you write about whatever you want. But there are people who, you know, are living in this country who were immigrants, and they carried that attitude with them, and I saw it in the parents of my friends. You could just see that different attitude. And I know it's hard for people who kind of were born here and grew up here to know that. And that's part of the purpose of my book. So where is this American character still alive? This character to me is illustrated by a painting by Norman Rockwell called Freedom of Speech. I know it's one of the four freedoms of FDR, which we don't agree with, but nonetheless, this is freedom of speech, so he included that. And to me, this kind of illustrates the character that Tocqueville was talking about. This is a man who is presenting his dissenting opinion, and this is at a town hall. And if you notice, something about him. What do you notice about him? He's a blue collar worker, right? He's a worker. Does that mean he is servile?
In some people's eyes.
In some people's eyes. What about in his own eyes?
In his own eyes, you think he's an equal.
He's an equal.
He believes he's an equal.
Yes, and is he given a platform?
Yeah.
No one's telling him to sit down and shut up, right? No one's saying know your place. He's offering his opinion in a town hall meeting, and that's what Tocqueville talked about. He talked about the local governments and how willing people were to pitch in and to help each other and to run things and to organize things. So that this illustrates it. And I was, you know, after seeing Nathan Brown and seeing these students that were just sort of following him, I thought, you know, you're in college. Why are you just following this professor? Anyone remember the Occupy movement? What were they doing when they didn't have microphones? Anybody remember? They're replaying it, right? They had the human mic. So someone, the speaker would say a phrase and people would repeat it. Well, one thing I noticed about the protest at UC Davis with Nathan Brown was he had a microphone and the students were still repeating what he was saying. And I thought, how much more brainwashed can you get than to sit there in a mob and just repeat after your professor? You know, the opposite of what this painting illustrates, at least in my eyes, you know, by his posture, by his very dignified stance, and other people listening to him. So where are these people? Okay, one of my heroes. This is Becky Gerritsen from the Wetumpka, Alabama Tea Party. This was last June. Anybody remember this hearing? Okay. Probably involved in the Tea Party yourselves, right? Okay, I'm having experience with the IRS myself because, as I said, I filed in February and I'm just getting a stone wall, though they did cash my check for $850 a long time ago. They took that money. But I was struck by what Becky Gerritsen said when she testified before the House Ways and Means Committee about the harassment of her group, which was one of the many, many groups that the IRS is targeting and slowing down the process of getting the applications through for nonprofit status. So she said, "I am not here as a serf or vassal. I am not begging my lords for mercy. I'm a born free American woman, wife, mother, and citizen. And I'm telling my government that you've forgotten your place." Talk about speaking truth to power. That's what the professors like to say. Speak truth to power. She continued, "It's not your responsibility to look out for my well-being and to monitor my speech. It's not your right to assert an agenda. Your post, the post that you occupy, exists to preserve American liberty." Those are stirring words, okay? You serve me. Your role is to preserve liberty. The difference between what happened in Russia and what happened in the West. The Communist Party never really gained that many adherents. Of course, there were spies, there were people spreading the ideas of communism, but as far as the official membership, as Harvey Clare and his colleague point out in their books, it was never that big. And it's because of this attitude. Well, this is changing, I'm afraid. Right. So we get back to Bill Ayers and teaching in the public schools, or specifically in the